Recorded interview today. It's just before the start of People's Internet Radio, which is going to be live, you know, in 7 p.m. this evening Eastern Time. And I have with me John A. Taylor, a retired member in good standing at the International Association of Firefighters, Professional Firefighters of Stewart Local 2411. You worked emergency medical service ambulance from 1987 to 1990, graduated in 1990, paramedic school, Palm Beach Community College, California, Florida, paramedic certified, hired Martin County EMS, 1993, hired for Stewart Fire Rescue, completed Fire Academy, Indian River Community College, and I mean, yeah, it goes on.
And I then go on, don't I? I think that was done as kind of a CV too. They were asking me, so I apologize for that.
So, but I'll just like kind of skip and then just go to, so from 2002 until the present, you've been researching advocate, firefighter health issues, 9/11 building collapse issues, and child sex trafficking, child abuse issues, 1,000 hours of research on all of the above.
Probably, I think that's 10, it should be 10,000 at least.
Right.
A lot of research. Yeah, a lot of research.
So we're gonna talk about the vigil that you participated in on Monday in D.C. for Seth Rich, because the 10th of June was the 1 year anniversary of his death. I didn't even realize that it's already been a year. I mean, I literally like thought that this guy was kind of killed just sort of like a few months ago when George Webb was, you know, talking about, you know, his murder not, you know, being solved. So
George was there. George and Jason were at the vigil.
Right. I wish I could have gone. You know, I just, I need support and donations in order to fund.
I hear you. I get there by the skin of my teeth myself, but.
So yeah, just talk a little bit briefly about who is Seth Rich, what happened.
Well, sometimes I get really surprised that a lot of people just don't even know anything about him, but a lot of people know a little bit about him, and I know more than I ever thought I would. He was a staffer at the DNC. An IT guy. He was apparently also a Bernie supporter, and now that's being denied heavily. But every Matt Couch has been investigating this. George Webb, Jason Goodman, Crowdsource the Truth. Everything that I have heard as far as factual information out of those people. Were that he was a big-time Bernie supporter, and during the campaign became aware. I mean, working there and being, you know, a smart person as I think he was, it would be pretty. I don't think he even had to work there to know that the DNC was working against Bernie Sanders. So there was some level of disgruntlement, I would imagine. You know, like I said, I wasn't there, and all of us weren't there, but that's kind of what we're hearing. And then all of a sudden, there were the WikiLeaks emails that were leaked, and Kim.com has come out and said that Seth Rich was the leaker, and all the research has been done, and George Webb's really big on metadata you know, the fingerprints of electronic data, and everything that they've been able to unearth is that they were not hacked. It was not a hack. There might have been a hack to cover up the leak, but the Awan brothers, I don't know if you're familiar with them or not.
Yeah, the Awan brothers, yeah. Right, that George Webb is always... I know, it really... If you know, for people that aren't familiar with George Webb, you know, go to his YouTube channel. I mean,
absolutely.
Yeah, you're going to need, I mean, I was going to say, you know, that's the problem with all of this stuff. You really need a lot of time to devote to understanding it. But my attitude is, what else is there to be doing? Like, if you're doing anything else.
Watching Family Feud or, you know.
Well, I mean, you know, people.
Is the show even on anymore? You know?
People will say, you know, they have children and they have their jobs and all of that. But that's the whole point. I mean, if you don't have the time and energy to be focusing on what needs to be focused on, that's how it's allowed to continue.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
It's time to get fit. It's time to get fit. I mean, it's way long overdue time to get fit in this country, you know.
So, you know, again, going on with Seth Rich's, you know, kind of timeline and story. So he's working there. This leak happens, and suddenly, shortly after it, he's murdered. And this is, you know, I was in, obviously, emergency services for about 30 years. I interacted with police departments. We rolled on murder investigations as, you know, emergency medical, not as police, but we interacted you know, homicides, death scenes, you name it. So I'm pretty familiar with the procedure, or at least the procedures as were in the departments in my surrounding area. And just looking at it on the surface, and a year later, it's the most wacky, crazy excuse for an investigation that I've ever seen. I can't imagine what's going on at the DC Police Department. I don't know. And with the most ridiculous part, and Neil Wolf got an interview.
Yeah.
He's on LightReports.com, and he got a 36-minute interview with this Bauman guy, who's a Democratic operative. He's a crisis manager guy that supposedly is volunteering his services to Seth Rich's family, and this guy in 36 minutes couldn't even confirm what hospital he was taken to. And that, I mean, that is so ridiculous. And any experience I've ever had, you know, they don't even have to know who the victim is, and the law enforcement is releasing that there was a shooting and the victim went to so and so hospital. So that hasn't even been done. As far as I know, Washington D.C. is the probably most videoed city on the face of the earth, and not one shred of video evidence has become available. The police wear body cams. There's been freedom of information requests that have been denied, and nobody even knows if that footage even exists anymore. So it's just thing after thing after thing. And the story, you know, the basic story is that it was a botched robbery, and
really?
Only nothing was taken.
Right.
So
that's you can't even call it a robbery then.
No. I mean, who?
The guy
who
was murdered. I mean.
Yeah. Who came up with that? I guess that was just the cover story that they ran with, hoping, you know, people would buy it. But it's crazy. And George has done, and also Matt Couch. I mean, they've walked those routes. They went over the timelines. They're talked to the people, and that one guy at the bar, Joe's bar there. I'm trying to remember his name. God, if I had a brain, I'd be dangerous. But I think people know who he is. He's one of the, you know, more known people in that whole story. He was actually in the mayor's video, her re-election video. This Joe guy. And I just, his last name escapes me right now, but at any rate, it's not hard to find. But this guy has told, I think, four different stories.
And who
to what happened to Seth? Supposedly he left there drunk. They offered him a ride. They didn't offer him a ride. You know, he left on his own. He walked. You know, this guy, the bar owner, is full of shit. I'm sorry, I made a curse, but it's just. ridiculous, the information coming out of him. And it's just item after item after item make no sense at all. I mean, it obviously, and I don't believe in coincidence, you know, with his job and the leak happening at the same time. I don't, you know, if you want to believe that's a coincidence, you can. I don't, you know. There was obviously, and Podesta in the emails, you can read it, they were looking for whoever this person was that leaked those emails, and I don't even think I'm paraphrasing. I'll quote him in that email. He said, you know, regardless if a person is culpable or not, he's all for making an example out of them. You know, so it's like, apparently he didn't care if they did it or not, but he was going to make an example of them. What that means, you know, I don't really know, but it doesn't sound good. And you know, apparently, you know, who knows what transpired, but there's facts available that he was handcuffed, that he was bruised, and the timeline after he left that bar, he was not just walking around. And he was supposedly very drunk when he left the bar, you know. And I don't drink anymore, but I used to. And the last thing that I would want to do is walk around for hours, you know, being drunk, or even try to walk home. I mean, there's taxi cabs that he supposedly was offered a ride. Yeah. None of it makes any sense. You know?
So he was killed in the street.
Yes.
And
yes.
Just and left in the...
this... Excuse me.
Sure.
So you have this George Washington University group that comes out with this. They've solved it, you know, that it was a professional killer. But they qualify that, well, it wasn't really like a CIA professional killer. It was some other kind of professional killer that, you know, obviously was skilled in what they did. He was targeted, okay? But they also, in like the next breath, say that there's an ATM camera that overlooked the scene, and that video footage got wiped out. So they put in there in the report, which is so ridiculous. It's like it was definitely not a CIA wet work type of assassination, but these, you know, half amateur professional, whatever they're calling these guys who supposedly did it, they were able to wipe that video footage out. So those are some pretty good amateurs, you know, and that's CIA all over. And to be, you know, that, you know, and I think they really believe we're all stupid, you know, but to put that in a report, it definitely wasn't the CIA, but, oh yeah, that camera footage somehow disappeared, you know, with I guess the body cam footage of the police and everything else. We're looking into, because I tried to give them a little, George and Matt, a fire department perspective of some stuff that they can look for, and apparently some of the vehicles in D.C. have dash cams, so that's another venue. And there's something called an NFIRS report. It's N-F-I-R-S, that every call that any fire department in the United States runs on, they have to fill one of those out, and it says the time of the call, it assigns it a run number, it tells you, you know, how the call came in, you know, was it enhanced 911, you know, what was it, you know, direct dispatch. There's a few different ways that the call could come in, and it would tell you the units that responded, the time they responded, the time they got on scene, the time they got available, you know, if somebody was transported into what facility, that would be in that report, and maybe even, not always, usually most any patient information is not in those reports, but If you're rolling on a gunshot wound, I would think somewhere in that report they would notate something like that, or at least what they were dispatched to, which would be a gunshot wound. And that report has not been made available. I'm not sure if a FOIA has been requested on that, but they're going to attempt to do that. But the lack of information that has come out about this just is...
I believe in an interview, I think it was Neil Wolf's interview with George Webb, where, you know, George Webb was saying that I don't know if he was saying that none of these reports are available, that he was saying that they don't exist, like they don't have them, or there aren't any, or something.
And that's pure crap, because if they're talking about the NFIRS report, that And the other thing that does exist in some form is a medical treatment report, which is confidential and it's covered under HIPAA, but it exists. It has to exist. That's the law, that those reports be filled out and completed, especially with a gunshot wound. And the National Fire Incident Report that does exist is somewhere. You know, they can't say it doesn't exist, because it's done on every call. I don't care if it's a fire call, right, or an EMS call, whatever. If the wheel turns in a DC fire apparatus or in an EMS apparatus, one of those reports has to be filled out. So that's just crap if they're saying these don't exist.
And do you know anything about whether, because I've heard things that Julian Assange even kind of admitted that.
Yes, heavily hinted.
That Seth Rich was the leaker.
And, of course, a big part of what Assange does is protecting sources. But he can't protect Seth anymore.
Right.
Know? But he has to deal with other people that are whistleblowers that are trying to get information out. So he can't come out and say Seth Rich was the one. You know, he can't say that. He'd like to, but he's hinted in every way possible.
And then most recently, Sean Hannity came out speaking about Seth Rich. And, you know, again, like, you know, this is just kind of recent things that have happened. And then he was, like, retaliated against first for, you know, I mean, you know.
I believe that. And when we were doing the vigil, there was maybe the possibility that, you know, Hannity was going to support it. And that evaporated like water on a hot blacktop. That was gone. And all of a sudden, I didn't hear anything else about it, out of him about the case. I just want to say, too, Scott Taylor, who's the local ABC reporter, has done exemplary work on this case. He and I'm sure he's put his job and his career at risk doing it. And that other, oh God, there goes the memory again. But there was another reporter that came out and was doing coverage on Pizzagate.
You're talking about Ben Swan.
Ben Swan. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Kat. Because I got two brain cells and one's on life support.
No, it's hard. It's hard to keep up with all of this stuff. I know. So I was going to actually just try to look up the Sean Hannity and what he said about, on Seth, you know, just to see, let's see, videos.
Well, I think he had made the connection that the DNC, was probably somebody at the DNC in that whole apparatus was complicit in the murder. You know, I think he's made that leap. I'm pretty sure he's talked about Podesta's email talking about finding this guy and making an example of him, you know. So I don't know. I can't, you know, paraphrase or even summarize what Hannity actually said, because I don't know that. But he's not a dumb guy, and if he was talking about
that
investigation, you know, I'm sure he would have included Podesta. I'm sure he would have included Debbie Wasserman Schultz. You know,
so
the one that three attorneys have been murdered, and just please, whoever's listening too, and I'm sure you already know this, Kat, but Jarrett Beck and his wife Elizabeth are the ones that are the plaintiffs. Some of the plaintiffs, the main plaintiffs in the DNC fraud lawsuit. And they've been threatened. They're down in Florida. There have been three attorneys murdered in the last three to 6 months. You know, I don't even think it's been 6 months. One of them being a U.S. attorney who was investigating, guess what, the Iwan brothers and the diplomatic visas that they had. And he turned up in the surf in Hollywood, Florida with his head bashed in.
Oh, boy.
That's a U.S. attorney, and his name was Wisenhan. Very competent, well-heeled U.S. attorney. And I can't believe, and I have to think that Sessions must have somebody on that murder.
So there's...
Another coincidence. All three of the murdered attorneys were working in some respect on either the A1 Brothers stuff or the DNC lawsuit, that type of thing, or DNC corruption, and they were all in Wasserman Schultz district. So that is that a coincidence? I don't think so.
Not like Seth Rich dying after this information was leaked is also a coincidence. But I found this one video of Sean Hannity, so...
I have to start tonight on a personal note about something that happened last week. Now, I was asked by the family of the DNC staffer that was killed in July to pull back covering the story of the death because their son and their family was hurting. Now, their family had a consideration, seeing the pain that they were going through. They told me a number of times what was happening with them, and I was honestly glad to accommodate them because, as a father... I know that I would probably never recover if I lost one of my kids. I honestly don't think it's possible. I cannot imagine the pain this family has gone through. Now, out of respect for the family's wishes, well, I decided, for the time being, not to discuss it unless there are further developments. But I also promised you, my audience, my loyal audience, that I will not stop investigating, I will not stop asking questions, and at a very high level, the bottom line here is the family wants the truth, and I think the country deserves the truth because this impacts so much of what the narrative in this country is now about, which is the left and their conspiracy theory. Now, I can report, I am making progress. We will have a lot more coming probably sooner than later. And I want to address this because, well, I have now been labeled by liberals, members of the Destroy Trump media, a conspiracy theorist. Why? Let me explain. Now, as we've been telling you on this program for months, Democrats and the media continue to push the Russia collusion Trump narrative without a shred of evidence. Nothing. Now, if evidence, pay close attention, if it ever does become available, we will report it on this program. However, just this past weekend, former Obama Director of National Intelligence James Clapper said he never saw a smoking gun or smoking gun evidence that collusion with the Trump campaign and Russia ever existed.
That's also been going on for a year.
Okay, yeah, that's the the date of this, hold on one sec. So it's May 30th of this year, so it's like less than 2 months ago. But then there's, you know, there's it is kind of strange. Like, why would the family be telling somebody who's, like, seeking the truth to back off? I mean, that doesn't make any sense unless they're being threatened or something.
Well, they're being handled. And listen to that interview that Neil Wolf got with Bauman. That is the most bizarre. And it was weird. It was like somebody that has consciousness of guilt that wanted to tell the truth. But then he remembers, and may have been put in that position, that he knows if he does, he's next, you know. But it was like, you really have to listen to it for yourself, but it was totally, anybody that would be in that PR field to really, and it's not like it was, you know, Dan Rather calling, you know, and Neil's a great guy, he's a good journalist, but, you know, he's alternative media, you know, and the fact that he got through, and then this guy spent 36 minutes on the phone, you really have to go to Light Reports on Twitter or lightreports.com, and I'm sure they have that posted.
On YouTube or on Twitter?
It might be on YouTube also, but if you go to... I think it's at Light Reports.
The Light Reports. Yeah.
The Light Reports, yep. On Twitter, I'm sure you can find a link to that. I think it's thelightreports.com, and I'm sure it's on their website.
See, I tried finding on his, on Neil's YouTube channel.
Now, wait, I'm barely competent. Technically, with technology, but let me see if I can find that link and Skype it to you of that interview.
Yeah, I was looking for his posts, and there aren't any. Maybe he didn't get a chance to put them up yet, but...
That interview has... I know it's been all over the place. Let me see if I can find you that link, Kat. No guarantees, but at least give it a shot. And I think if you just Google search Bauman interview or Bauman plus Neil Wolf plus interview, you'll find it. But let me see if I can.
How do you spell? Is it Bauman? Bowman?
I think it's Bauman.
Okay, here, I got it.
You got it? Okay. I had a feeling you were going to find it.
I mean, it's a half an hour. Do you want me to,
That's the one. People need to listen to that whole interview. And remember that this guy is a public relations expert, supposedly. And, the strange way he describes... To me, it seemed like, you know, he's really not a bad guy, and he knows, well, I'm blasting you out with that sunlight, it was like he wanted to be able to speak more about it, and he knows he can't, and the things that they won't even talk about are just ridiculous, like, what difference could it possibly make if the spokesman for the family says, yes, he went to MedStar. I mean,
He went to where?
MedStar is the hospital.
Oh, I see.
It's a trauma center. It's the closest facility. He went to MedStar. And unless the D.C. Fire Department, you know, had a stroke, you know, while they were on scene and became mentally incompetent... you know, in my experience too, you're going to take a shooting victim to the closest appropriate facility, which in that case was MedStar, and it's a trauma hospital. It's a trauma. They specialize in trauma.
Do you want
it's a trauma center?
Do you want me to play? Like, do you know like where in this video?
I'm not sure. You mean in the audio of the interview?
Right. I mean it's.
I wouldn't know what part to tell you to play, but I think everybody should just if you get that link out and just listen to it, because you'll be like scratching your head like, oh my god.
Okay, man, I'm just gonna start it right here just by let me just try this.
Sure.
Let me just run back to my desk. I've got it right here.
Sure. Coffee's good. I needed that. I was on the road for about 12 hours today.
Oh, okay. Boy. Okay.
A little peek it, but I'm making it.
Says that this was posted by R-H-O-P-Y-J-A-G. Some uppercase, some lowercase in there. Your surgery resident here.
Oh, did you want to say something? Yeah, the audio quality is not so great.
I can tell you what they're talking about now. He's talking to him about a post that appeared on 4chan that supposedly, and it was very well written, because I've been a paramedic for years and years and years, and whoever wrote that had some pretty extensive, sounds like a surgery resident in a trauma center, and that's who he said he was, but he was remaining anonymous. But that's what they're talking about, the 4chan. And Bauman comes back, oh, yes, I read that. I know, you know, it's like, really? You did? Yeah, that's supposed to be, conspiracy theory disinformation. But he's well-versed on all of it. So that's another odd thing.
So
you know,
it's like
if you're representing the family and you're interested, you know what the truth is, and your function is to dispel anything that's not true. Why would you be so intimately aware and familiar with stuff that's appearing on anonymous chat rooms. that's a little weird, I thought. So
this guy...
That's that part of the interview, anyway.
This guy, Brad Bowman, is the spokesperson for Seth Rich's family, parents.
Yeah. Yeah. Supposedly working pro bono.
Wow. I mean, what does it entail to be a spokesperson?
That light's blinding me. It must be killing you. Let me see if I change locations here or do something. Because that, boy.
So, I guess just like, talk about the vigil then on Monday.
Oh, yeah. Sure, certainly. So, and I'd like to thank my partner on traffic reports, Howard Kaplan. Pizzagate Howie, he's known as also, a.k.a. he's been investigating that for quite some time. And he did a heck of a lot of work. There was also other people involved. Marie McKenna was involved and did a hell of a lot of work. And a few other people that really... I'm not going to name right now because they just don't, it's such a volatile, you know, case that what they do, but they're professionals in public relations, and they did so much work on that, and the media coverage that we got there was incredible. I mean, we had about 40 people that just attended, myself included, but I mean, having George Webb there, having Jason Goodman there, having, John, forgive me, I don't know his last name, but he's the Washington reporter for OAN Network. I mean, this guy is like, you know, he's a real D.C. political reporter. He was there. WND was there. Matt Couch was there. And it was just a tremendous, I wish the public support would have matched the media dedication to be there, because it was really awesome. And I'm actually writing a letter to Scott Taylor and some of the other journalists that were there, kind of just thanking them. And you know, I can't really apologize, because it's really, we weren't in control of how many people that were going to actually show up. And like with an event like that, there was all sorts of reasons that it might have never happened. but getting the turnout that we did, and I got some, there was a lot of, you know, great stuff that came out of there. I think it is going to have an effect. It really shone a spotlight on the case. It was intended to be a silent vigil, and that's what it was. And through some scheduling things and some circumstances beyond our control, we weren't able to get a permit. So we didn't plan on. We gathered in Spirit Park, so we weren't going to stay there. We were going to walk, and we were going to walk to the DNC and do the silent vigil, which we did. And it was a weird coincidence on the same day. And probably, I talked with a D.C. Police officer, Sergeant, who I won't give his name, but he was on scene, and he tried to get us a permit to stay in that park. And was unsuccessful, and it's hard to do. And I think the rank and file police are all for solving this, and all for people coming out and a public outcry. But he was unable to do that, and so we really hadn't intended staying in the park. We were going to go over to the DNC, and that did happen. And there was a few people there, and we didn't control. We didn't say this person can come, you can't come, but we tried to insist that, it was about the silent vigil, and that did take place for about 15 or 20 minutes, and it was powerful. I mean, I was running around trying to make sure, people were where they needed to be, and I was trying to get some video footage to document it, and I heard the silence start. And that was, Howie was the one that organized, because some people were chanting, some people were doing this and that, and Howie organized them enough to just stop that. And everything, you could have heard a pin drop. And I literally whipped my head around. And it was stunning. And 40 people and another, maybe 20 news media stood there in front of the Democratic National Headquarters, where he worked, and stood in silent protest. And it was very moving, you know, and it, very powerful. And, you know, I think that that powerful message is going to have some good effect on this case to solve it. And the, after that was over, some people were using the megaphone, which we weren't really crazy about, but it's not like we could stop them. You know, we tried to influence what we could, and when the vigil had already taken place, it was basically over.
Neil Wolf was saying how, like, you know, the employees coming out of the DNC were, you know, like laughing or smirking.
It was disgusting. It really was. You know, I thought it was a bad joke. I had heard that they dedicated a bike rack to Seth Rich, and wow. I got to see the plaque and the bike rack, which to me is just a joke, you know. And I think there was a message that wasn't a memorial, that was a message to anybody else that works there. And unless you want to get an extension of this bike rack donated in your name, you'll shut the hell up. I didn't know any of this. I've never been to the DNC before, but right down the building there's a club, so I guess that's where the really big wigs go. And these guys, obviously suits, showed up in the middle of the vigil, and they're like giving everybody dirty looks, and Liberty Colonist was there and asked them, you know, just what do you think about the vigil? And the guy just automatically turned on him. Why are you making this political? And don't you respect the wishes of the family? And you know, the family, I didn't hear any wishes that they didn't want to have a silent vigil, you know. And the second point was, you know, is the point that he's making is that the family does not want this solved and does not want the public to do everything that they can to make sure that it's solved. It made no sense. And the only thing, and there was people, there were Bernie supporters. People were Bernie supporters there. There were people that probably a lot fewer of those, but supported Hillary. There were Trump supporters, there were independents, there were apolitical people at that rally. You know, we got people from Dallas, we got people from Tennessee.
Lady was from, wasn't she from like Mississippi or something, or Memphis, one lady?
Memphis, yep.
Yeah, yeah.
Memphis, Tennessee, home of Elvis. But it was a shame. And I got to say, Kathy McHale, she follows the traffic report, and we're at traffic, TRAFFICK report 1 on Twitter. We do a weekly, twice a week show that's primarily about child trafficking awareness, right. What to do and how to prevent it and how to stop it. But we also cover the corruption because it's hand in hand. I mean, one doesn't exist without the other. So that's why we got involved with the Seth Rich vigil, because it seems to be probably the piece of corruption that might be changed the easiest right now, because Congress is not going to change, but putting pressure on a public servant agency, the Metropolitan Police, you know, seems like a pretty good way to get this. And if it's solved correctly, I think the whole side of that system.
So what
will collapse?
What is the connection then between the murder of Seth Rich and child sex trafficking?
It's just another form of corruption, you know, and the corruption is multi-layered.
Was he exposing that? He was exposing?
No. But I mean, like I said, I think I said it's probably closer to 20,000 hours that I've spent researching child trafficking, researching 9/11, researching, you know, and it's all about corruption, human compromise, the reason our Congress doesn't work, the reason they're not screaming for this to be solved, the reason they're not, you know, doing appropriate investigations of things that are really wrong, like the Iwan brothers, AWAN. Or that our ports are like Swiss cheese, you know, and that's some of the greatest reporting George Webb has done. He basically stopped any future false flag at a U.S. port, you know, by his coverage and forcing the Homeland Security and the Coast Guard into the public eye to respond to a possible, you know, radiological threat, which is there. And then we find out that there's these huge tractor trailer size containers that are coming through any port you name that could have anything in them. They're not placarded, they're not marked in any way, and they can bring in whatever they want. What on earth does the diplomatic mission of Pakistan need in four? And that's just the tip of the iceberg, apparently, because they come through. There's a lot more than them come through. But what do they require at the diplomatic mission that requires truckloads full of stuff? You know, it's crazy. And our firefighters are at extreme risk when that's going on, because any contraband or any hazardous material or dirty bomb or, you know, explosive, whatever they're bringing in, you know, we don't know that's in there. It's obviously been being hidden. And then it came to light that same week when George was reporting that by Russian television, that they had found these containers with radiological contents that were being flown on aircraft. And their excuse was we we mislabeled them and we mislabeled the invoices. Really? Well, when I went to school, any amount. Hi. Whoa, that was a good catch. It's a nice camera. Cat-like reflexes.
The stand is a little bit
shaky.
Yeah.
I thought it was me.
Let me just finish this
one thought really quick. But okay. In this, the laws of the Code of Federal Regulation and the United Nations, who oversee hazardous materials, any amount of radiological substance being transported by any means, air, sea, land, must be placarded. So obviously that law is being violated, and if you and I violated that with a teaspoon of some radioactive isotope that even wasn't harmful, if we sent that in the mail, we'd do 25 years in prison. In the hell is going on? So that type of corruption allows the child trafficking networks to operate. They use the child trafficking networks to compromise politicians.
Yeah.
So it's one big circle, you know. And until we take out a piece of it and collapse it, whether it's the Seth Rich murder, whether it's the Iwan brothers, whether it's the attorneys that have been murdered in Florida, when one of those pieces comes down, that's the only chance you have to collapse that whole circle. And, you know, you can't. I mean, I worked for... You know, it finally dawned on me after years of working on 9/11 issues that is not going to be solved, and it's not going to be solved with the corruption that's there, because there's no desire for it to be solved in our legislative.
I think it's pretty safe to say that we're like living in a country with almost I would say total lawlessness. Just people in power just doing whatever they want.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
It,
for the government.
Right.
The laws apply to you and me. Like I said, if we got caught with through an airport, we're going to federal prison for 25 years.
Yeah, the so-called laws are like the volume is turned, the flame is turned like up full blast and turned completely off for them. And up full blast for us. So, I guess we can, like, you know, wrap it up in the next couple of minutes. And,
I hope I can come back and talk to you again, because you're a great interviewer and your knowledge is, you made it really easy, because I'm kind of a little beat up today. And I thought this was going to be, but you made it a very pleasant experience. So anytime you want me to run my mouth about any of these issues, I'd be more than glad to. Hopefully I'll be in a location where I'm not, you know, moving around and I got all this craziness going on. But yeah, the vigil and everything else was pretty, you know, dynamic. And I'm glad I got to be a part of it. And I'm glad people like yourself are interested in it.
The issue of child child abuse and child sex trafficking and satanic ritual abuse is, you know, I mean, again, like, I literally have been trying to speak out about child abuse, you know, mostly in the home, you know, psychological or physical abuse or whatever, all my life, you know. I mean, all my life, and, you know, was met with the same kind of experiences. Like, people just criminalize and condemn you for speaking out about this stuff while bailing out and making excuses for the abuser. And I attribute it all to the monetary system and the fact that we live in a debt-based monetary system, which makes people forced to live in a backwards debt-based way of thinking, and, you know, right, like leaving the debt for the people who can afford it the least instead of raising them, you know. So, right, like people are not aware that the powers that be are watering down the money supply and creating it out of thin air, you know, and they're not paying attention to the effect that that's having on their mental and physical health. And
yes. I'll leave you with this. If you had good health care, if every American had adequate housing, education, medical care,
decent wages.
What would decent wages, all of those things. I mean, believe me, I'm a union guy, big time. And the firefighters, I mean, I had to work two jobs when I got hired on the fire department. The pay was so bad, you know, and I loved it. You know, I didn't do it for the pay. But, you know, the unions are very important. They're being destroyed. But that's an argument for another day. But my point is, if we had all those things, we'd have nothing else to do. It's for you and I to sit around and use our brains and pick apart all this programming, for lack of a better word.
I mean, I don't understand how people find the time to have a job when there's all this corruption and you know, abuse going on that, you know, I mean, it's so bizarre, because the whole point of going to work every day and having jobs should be to be making the world a better place, and yet it's the exact opposite of that. Like, with all the people that go to work every day and get paid to do what? Like, you know,
and none of it scares. Well, hopefully the next time we'll talk about the $43 trillion,
yeah.
Trillion with a T. The, you know, the Pentagon, Rumsfeld admitted 2.3, then it went to 8. Catherine Fitz, who was the assistant secretary of HUD, has followed the money. $43 trillion. That's enough to pay for health care, education, housing, nobody going unfed, you know, eliminate poverty. That's 100 times the amount of money that you need to do that. So this is a game. You know, we're being played and we're being ripped off. And until we stand up and show up to things like the Vigil for Seth Rich and stand beside those few people right now that are willing to stand up, and they are, they're putting their butts on the line, and that includes news media. But if we don't stand together, every party, every persuasion, every race, every creed, if we don't join hands, and that, if I'm not mistaken, that was MLK's message, and it rings even truer today, if we don't do that, our future as a species is not something I ever want to see, or any relatives or children, or any of their children.
What I find astonishing, you know, again, from studying like the abusive family system all my life, I could always see how, you know, we're all just pretty much raised to just get jobs, you know, keep the system going and not really be empowered and not live to your full potential, like your full level of health and intelligence and capability.
Work hard, work long, and die.
And what,
that's the object.
Right, and what I find astonishing, because I try to empower people, like I try to get people to come together and have better families, have healthier, fitter, more empowering, you know, relationships. And what is so amazing today is that the powers that be, the Satanists, the pedos, they know how more valuable you are than the people do, because they're using your body, your sweat, you know, right, selling your body parts and all this stuff, you know, your kids' body,
your organs.
Like, they know how valuable you are. I mean, and they're profiting off of it. I mean, what the hell? Like why can't the people do that for themselves in a better way, of course?
Yeah. until we fill the streets with our presence and demand that this stop en masse, in numbers, and not in political groups, but as human beings, American citizens.
Exactly.
As citizens of the planet that we live on. You know, there's a lot of citizenship, you know, and I just don't think of myself as I think of myself as a human being. If you don't start with that and kind of stay with that, the country stuff and the world stuff can get very crazy, and you know, we have to, as human beings, you know, stand together and stand up. And I think it's starting. I think there's a lot in the air, and I really have this is the first time I felt in a long time a little hope. You know, dare I say hope?
It's
a four-letter word.
Where can people find your Twitter and your Facebook?
On Twitter, we have the traffic report, it's traffic report, TRAFFICK, like child traffic, TRAFFICK, capital REPORT 1. Traffic report 1, and also I'm Fireman John 628 on Twitter. That's pretty easy to remember. You can get a hold of me that way. Traffic report has a Facebook page. It's called the Traffic Report Radio Show. You can find that relatively easily on Facebook. We're on Tuesdays and Thursdays at 11:59. You know, I better get some sleep because me and Howie will be on. But yeah, join us. We live tweet the shows. We've gotten a tremendous. We're building a network, you know, yourself included. I mean, this is a network, you know, a network of human beings that have had enough of this.
Yeah.
And if enough of us stand up, and I think that's going to happen in the not too distant future, this will change.
Thank you. Thank you, John Taylor. Have a great night.
Salute, Cat Waters.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Amen.
Anytime. We'll talk again soon, I hope.
Okay. Have a great night.
God bless. All right.
You too.
Bye-bye, kid.
Bye.